What's the cause of schizophrenia? And is there evidence for neurodevelopmental problems that involve glutamate? And yes, there is. The classical theory about how mental illnesses are formed, that you have this gene for mental illness, which creates a gene product that's no good, and then you get sick. Guess what that is? Gone. There is no gene for any mental illness. Genes don't code for mental illness. Genes code for proteins and epigenetic modulators. So nobody thinks a single gene causes any mental illness, and it looks like hundreds of genes may conspire, particularly not only with themselves, but with the environment, and that's what causes mental illness. So here's the nature part. You get a few hundred of the bad genes. Remember how many genes you got? You got about 20,000 genes or so. Evidence so far suggests that maybe 100 or 200 of them are linked to schizophrenia. But if you add up all those genes, the polygenic risk scores, the additive effect of all your genes, it's not even still 50% of the reason you get schizophrenia. It's a few percent. But it does hit neurotransmitter systems, synaptogenesis, plasticity, cognition, psychosis, and stress. No question they have a factor. What's the other factor? Nurture. Environmental stress factors, sometimes obstetric events, sometimes abusive childhood. Early childhood adversity is a huge problem for all sorts of mental illness, including psychosis. Maybe some viruses or toxin. You know what one of the worst toxins is? If you have the bad genes for schizophrenia that are quiet, go out and smoke marijuana. It's estimated that in Europe, an estimate was recently done, that 12% of all first episode cases of psychosis could be prevented across Europe if high potency marijuana smoking was stopped. Maybe as high as a third in London and a half of the cases in Amsterdam. So there's something particularly toxic about marijuana in people who have a diathesis, or if you will, a risk for schizophrenia in their genes. Traumatic experiences and bullying. Put these together and somehow they all impinge on the brain, and they can cause disconnectivity, abnormal long-term potentiation, problems with plasticity and connectivity. And I'm going to talk in a little bit about abnormal competitive changing of your synapses. And when that happens, you break down. Hallucinations, delusions, thought disorder. And if you've got all those, you get schizophrenia. That's the current theory. It's complicated. Many factors, and still being researched. Here are some susceptibility genes. I could have put a table here of 100 or 200. You can look this up in the book if you wish. But these change every time I write the new edition of the book. The susceptibility genes change. We really don't know what are the important genes for schizophrenia yet. But we're suspicious that glutamate's involved in neurodevelopment. And if neurodevelopment doesn't work right, because glutamate doesn't work right, that's why you get schizophrenia. So here you've got a stem cell which is made into immature neurons between conception and well before birth. And then what happens is that your brain, interestingly enough, while it's still being formed, assassinates about 90% of your neurons. It makes 10 times more neurons than you need. Why it does that way, it makes all these extra ones, maybe it's so that you have a plethora of good stuff on the shelf so you can make a great brain out of it. I don't know. But it is true that you eliminate a lot of them. What if you selected the wrong ones off the shelf? So there's some worry that even from the get-go, when your brain's forming, the wrong neurons are selected. Then, once you've selected them, even if they're the right nerves, they have to move. They have to migrate. They have to go to the places where they have to go. And they usually kind of hitchhike a ride, as you can see there, kind of, you know, going up the pole a little bit. That's like a glial pole, and they go to the right places. They differentiate. They get myelinated. And then they form connections. And then the connections wire like crazy when you're young. So that happens during adolescence. And then you, funny enough, you assassinate half of your neurons when you turn to an adolescent, all their connections, not the neurons, but the connections. So you make too many neurons before birth, and you make too many synapses after birth, and then you reorganize the brain in adolescence. And that is when schizophrenia occurs. So what if this is birth, and you got your full complement of neurons, because you don't make very many more neurons after birth. That's it. You make more connections. You wild like crazy. Look at that. By age 6 or so, you've got like more connections than you'll ever have in your life. And then you remodel the brain in adolescence, and this is the period of time when you collect and catch schizophrenia. So it's thought that maybe something is wrong with the selection of connections in schizophrenia, and much of which neurons are selected and which connections are selected is based upon glutamate, because the strength of a synapse is based to its glutamate receptors. And so if you have a weak synapse, it gets thrown out. Well, if you don't strengthen the right synapses and you eliminate those that you need, maybe you uncover schizophrenia during this restructuring period. If you don't believe the brain restructures, you've never had an adolescent in your house. The brain is on fire restructuring. It's a normal part of development, but it can uncover schizophrenia. So the neurodevelopment hypothesis of schizophrenia say you have certain key genes that might lead to bad synapse formation, not enough LTP and stuff. And if you're okay on the top, these genes for these funny names, dysbindin and so forth, allow you to strengthen. Look at how many AMPA receptors there. The number of AMPA receptors you have tells how strong the synapse is, how much you use it. It's use it or lose it. And that one's been used. How about the puny one at the bottom? Flawed genes, bad synaptic connections. You don't use it. It's not strong. Guess what? That is the guy that gets eliminated. Now, if he's a puny bad synapse normally, you want to get rid of him. That's called normal brain development. But if you have the wrong synapses competitively eliminated because you have some wrong signal in your glutamate from your genes, then maybe you get schizophrenia. Finally, there is some evidence that schizophrenia may be neurodegenerative. First of all, there's a prodrome. Remember, that prodrome can be related to what I just talked about. The aberrant restructuring of the synaptic connections in your brain during adolescence. It sets you up. God forbid you smoke marijuana during this time. The other thing that happens is that during this prodrome, you become a little odd. Your IQ starts to fall. You may even hear some pre-psychotic kinds of ramblings in your head. You ignore them. But then what happens is, bingo, you get delusions, hallucinations, hospitalization. You're completely psychotic. And your brain looks normal because it's a slice through the brain, and those red areas are the normal size of a ventricle, which is where the fluid is in your brain. And then you recover a little bit. And then you get another episode, often because you don't take your medicines. That's usually what it happens. You've got a revolving door in and out of the hospital, and uh-oh, looks like that brain is sort of degenerating because the ventricles are filling up with fluid because the brain's being lost. Then you have another episode. Look at the ventricles. And another one, oh my God, the ventricles are huge. So you have a form of neurodegeneration, and there's some evidence that the duration of untreated psychosis is proportionate to the amount of brain you're losing. And you're not having all those neurotrophic things I've been talking about in earlier lectures. And your drugs are not being used consistently, and your brain doesn't know how to be trophic to keep the brain rich and fat and sassy with a lot of synapses. So then you end up having a response to medicines, but then as progressive brain tissue is lost, you end up being less responsive to medicines, and you have what's called, you know, a residual state of symptoms that really are not going to get better, and you have had a downhill course. That looks like degeneration. So maybe you have both neurodevelopment. And you know what? If you don't replace the synapses continuously, like you and I should be doing, in fact, if you're listening to this lecture, hopefully you are doing that. You are using your own neurogenesis to keep yourself fresh all the time. As adults, we try to keep our brains fresh. If you stop doing that, or your disease stops doing that, or you have psychosis and you don't treat it, it could be you stop making new synapses, and it's not really so much neurodegeneration. It's the lack of keeping things up ends up the same as if it was degenerating.